Welcome to 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org. I'm your host, Dave Death. And once again, Mike Liberty is lost at sea. Big surprise. But don't worry about it, because we have Spock from Colorado with us.
Yeah.
How's it going out there, Spock?
I'll tell you, the air is thin. When you arrive here for a visit, you better get ready, because climbing up two flights of stairs, you're going to be out of breath.
Well, I'm out of breath going up the hill to the to the local what do they call it, Dobago or whatever. What is it?
Bodega.
There you go. I'm dyslexic,
bodega.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, this guy, I live next to the worst freaking ghetto store ever. The guy has cigarettes like once a month. You know, he only carries Pepsi in 2 liters, so I can't have like rum and Coke. I got to have rum and Pepsi. And that's horrible. That's torture in itself.
I can't tell the difference.
I can tell the difference.
I can't tell the difference between like butter and margarine. Anyways, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Anyways, so yeah, we got a good show lined up for everybody tonight. We do have some new music. We got the new song from Group Love that just came out. We're going to play that for you here first on 13 Folds Radio. And we also have in our extended edition of the show the new Prophets of Rage. For those of you who haven't heard of that project yet, it's members of Rage Against the Machine, Public Enemy, and Cypress Hill, and we got their first big one that we're going to play for you guys, and we'll talk a little bit more about that, because that's pretty awesome. I'm excited about that. Probably more excited about that than I would have been for a Rage reunion, but we'll see. I want to hear it, and of course, we got other great music for everybody. We have some funny shit to talk about tonight. Lottery funding crime rings, a public Harris. How do you say that?
Harris.
The H is silent. All right. I never claimed I was smart, guys, but it's the.
Yeah, but you got a show.
she forgets she has Alzheimer's, and we'll explain the consequences of that. Trying to quit smoking, maybe e-cigs aren't the best answer. We'll talk a little bit about that.
Cool.
A couple of cops that obviously knew better but made the arrest anyway. It's a interesting piece about, what we know cops love and they know more about than any other person in society, and we're going to explain how they try to twist that into their advantage. American safe space, how it's ruining society. We got that. Teaching America's youth to grow up with realistic expectations. We're going to talk about all that tonight, if we can fit it in. And of course, we do have some interesting week in weed and an update from what's going on in Colorado.
Got it.
And that's why you're here. You need to bring us up to speed so we can get on board with things over here in Rhode Island.
Cool beans.
I'm counting on you for that.
Okay, I got it.
You need to make it happen. I've been trying. All I've been able to get done is I've been able to push through, and we got the agricultural bill passed, the industrial hemp bill. So that's finally passed here.
Oh, but there you go. Yeah, but you got a lot on your plate. I just got a whole bunch of notes here in front of me.
All right, so you got to start giving me some information I can use so we can get recreational set up here.
Well, there you go. You tell me when to start talking.
So, yeah, I mean, as far as the week goes, it was a pretty interesting week. We had the Democratic Convention going on, as we did last week's show.
Yes, that's right. Yep.
And now, from what I understand, the real highlight of the entire event was Michelle Obama's speech. Am I right?
I refused to watch the politics last week because it was Democratic.
Did you? But didn't you hear all the news? I didn't watch it. I heard all the talk about Michelle Obama's big speech was.
Well, she's a sweetheart, I think, and so anything that she says is going to be, I think, a lot more appealing and nice, and maybe make more sense than perhaps her husband.
Well, the line that everybody was talking about is she said that every night she puts her children to sleep in a house built by slaves. And I guess that made the most headlines.
Wow. Wow. Yeah.
Poor Michelle.
Cool. Yeah, she's cool.
I want a house built by slaves, man. Is that okay to say? I don't know.
Yeah. Go to the East Coast. No, you're already there. Go to the East Coast how do you think half of those buildings were made in Boston and in the greater metropolitan areas?
Yeah, well, even when they were paying people to do it, it was like slave labor.
Yeah.
Those are the days.
Well, I'm not sure you're supposed to say that.
Well, I was talking about the child labor aspect of it. I got a lot of kids, man. If we could have child labor, I'd be set.
I got 5. How many you got?
I got 5.
What? See, are you copying me?
Yeah, I'm trying not to. I was raised better than that.
Okay.
So anyway, guys, listen, we've babbled on long enough. Let's listen to some music, and then we'll come back and talk the shit and see what's going on in the world of politics, legalization, and probably Florida's got to be in there somewhere. So you're listening to 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org. This is Fiona Apple, Across the Universe.
I love this.
Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. They slither while they pass, they slip away across the universe. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy are drifting through my open mind, possessing and caressing me. Across the universe, thoughts meander like a restless wind inside a letterbox. They tumble blindly as they make their way across the universe. Across the universe,
Is it all? getting weaker. I know you want me near, but your love is what I fear. It's beautiful the way you move. What's a boy to do when he can't seem to choose? Yeah, beautiful, but I must explain. My mind's not in a good place, and so look, come down, please.
Don't touch me, boy.
Welcome back to 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org. I am Dave Death, and that is Spock from Colorado. And that was Someone That Loves You by Honey and Izzy Bizzou. Your local favorites down in Colorado, aren't they? We were talking earlier about safe space and how it's destroying the fabric of our society. I don't know. Have you ever gone to one of those hibachi grills where they cook the Japanese food on the grill right in front of you in a table full of people?
I love that. I mean, it's entertainment. Plus, I love exotic food, any kind of food. I love it. And I love those places. What about you?
I love those places too. I bring my daughters there for their birthdays every year. So needless to say, I spent a lot of money at those joints, but it's worth it. It's worth it.
Well, for,
It's an entertaining show.
Yeah.
Good food. Yeah. And part of the entertainment is it seems I've had it at every single one that I've gone to. They have the sake and they spray the sake out of the doll. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
And everybody's got to catch it in their mouth. Well.
Oh, I love it. Yeah.
Well, I guess there was an incident.
Oh, geez.
There was an incident.
Someone got hurt.
At a Japanese steakhouse in Tennessee where a chef sprayed a woman in the face with a pee-pee doll and what her husband is claiming a sexual style assault. Now.
Well, then don't bring it to Tennessee.
It's just, but that's ridiculous. It's like,
well, I know.
I guess they were eating. It's the Lassiter family. Thank you, Lassiter family, for fucking up everybody's entertainment next time they go to dinner to get a good hibachi grill in Tennessee. You can sleep proudly knowing that you fucked it up for everybody else after you. No sake shots.
Yeah.
I guess she wasn't happy. He pulled his little shorts down, and it had a wanger, and he squirted me right in the face.
Yeah, I've seen them. They're great.
Yeah, I love it. I think it's awesome.
One way of getting sake, you know.
I'm a male, and I'm not as offended by it.
No.
So
yeah.
I guess they're claiming it was a sexual style assault. They called the police. The police did not press charges. The woman said it really didn't have a wiener, but you got the point. Well, yeah, you got the point. The guy was trying to have fun, and not like he didn't have a wiener. Anyway, I'm so sick of the safe space bullshit, you know?
I'm so sick of limp dick people. Jesus Christ, come on.
Everybody's so easily offended. Too easily offended.
That's one of the, put it in the top 10 things about this country that I know and love, born and raised here, you know, there's about 5 or 10 things that people freak out over. And after a while, it's like, come on, people, hike up your big boy pants, for God's sake.
So other things that offend people, e-cigarettes. It was the big rave for the past, you know, 4 or 5 years. And actually, I'm trying to quit smoking. And I'm in the market for an e-cig, and I find out that I guess they're saying that a lot of the e-cigarettes emit a toxic vapor.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I read an article in a science magazine, a no bullshit, real stuff science magazine, that said that the chemicals that you're getting and the amounts are way over the top compared to cigarettes. Yeah.
So that's the thing, is I don't know. Is it worth it for me to go out on the limb and try the e-cig route, or?
You know.
It's got to be better than smoking cigarettes.
Can you stop? No. I'm sorry. The little crazy guy on my shoulder told me to say something stupid. I'm sorry.
But I don't know if it's the device itself as much as it is the compounds that they're using for the liquids, from what I understand.
Well, here you go. Would it be a better idea? Because I think this exists, or it surely exists here right in Fort Collins, Colorado. Go to the pot shops. You can get a whole supply of any kind of juice that you want to add instead of nicotine-oriented juice and put it into your e-cigarette. And then you got, you know, a joint. You got what you got.
The harmful compounds are in propylene, glycol, and glycerin. And I guess they cause the emissions of toxic chemicals. But I imagine you can get liquids without that stuff in it.
You can get it right here in Fort Collins. Pure THC squeezins out of pot, and you can put it right into your fake cigarette.
I'm going to go look into some of that over the next couple of weeks. I think there's actually a big convention coming on where they're going to have all the e-cigs and the vaporizing companies there. So maybe that's a good place to go and do some research and find out what alternatives there are. But yeah, I got to quit smoking. I can feel it taking years off my life as we speak.
Modern society says, oh, it's okay to smoke even in an e-cig, tobacco materials. But if you tried going through your everyday, instead of smoking 8 cigarettes, you tried smoking some THC pot squeezins juice, wherever you can get that, probably that would fuck up your day.
Well, see, but I can't like step out for a break at work and do that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so that's why I'm saying... So there's still part of it is maybe you got to try to back away from tobacco, but that's another whole show.
Or maybe, you know, crack. Try crack cocaine. I can't get enough of that.
I've never tried that. You know, there's a whole small handful of drugs that I've never tried. See what happens when you get older?
Yeah, I haven't gone down that route yet. Anyways, listen, we're going to play some old Muse for you guys. This song is called Shrinking Universe. And you're hearing it here on 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org.
Won't admit you love me, and so how am I ever to know? You only tell me, perhaps, perhaps, perhaps. A million times I ask you, and then I ask you over. Can't make your mind up. We'll never get started. And I don't wanna wind up being parted, broken hearted. So if you really love me, say yes. But if you don't, dear, confess. And please don't tell me. Heart.
you really love me? Say yes, but if you don't, dear, confess, and please don't tell me. Perhaps, 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 perhaps.
And we are back. You're listening to 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org. That was a new one from a band called Glass Animals. The song is Youth. You know, something a little bit different. What do you think, Spock?
I want to know, how do you find all these new different groups while I'm still, like, listening to, I don't know, Beatles and Led Zeppelin.
You know what? We've talked about this before. The digital age of music has made it so easy if you really want to go find new music and people, you know, unheard of. You just go out there, you look for different genres that you enjoy, and you do a lot of clicking, and you listen to a lot of shit.
But it must take a lot of time.
Yeah, there's hidden gems. There's kernels of corn in that shit. And that's what I do. I dig the corn out of the shit. That's my job.
I can't wait to visit you.
So what did we want to talk about first for our week in weed?
Week in weed. Let's see. Yeah. I got this out of a health. Can I say the name of the magazine on
go my, ahead. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. We like to cite our sources when they're real.
Oh yeah. Health Affairs Magazine. Okay. Wherever that comes from.
All right.
As you age and you eventually want to live long enough so that you get Medicare, your medical costs drop through the floor. They really, really get low. And that's very cool. Thank you, everybody, for making that for older people.
You're welcome. And, you're very welcome.
You know, and one of them is called Part D, which pays for all your medicines. How can you go wrong? So
part
anyway,
D?
Part D.
Okay. I was going to say Part D. Is that, that's funding set aside for weed?
Well, in the end, yes. Yeah. So what happens is more and more now, especially in the places where it's legal for either medical or recreational, there's two thirds of the states are that way now. What happens is, more and more people, according to this article right here, more and more people are beginning to take the advice of the greater medical institutions and lowering their use of medicines that aren't necessarily good to use over and over. You know, the opioid like
a supplement.
The supplement, you know, try to avoid antidepressants, things like that. And huge numbers of people in this country are now, particularly the older people, are starting to smoke grass. They're starting to go for that. And then in the end, not spend the money that to some people is very expensive. To buy the oxys and the other medicines that they want now,
and they're not aren't those covered by the Medicare?
Yes, they are. But here's the cool thing: in 2014, okay, it was so prevalent people doing this that the Medicare Part D people, the government. Notice that there was, are you ready? Here we go with another a dollar sign that has a B in front of it, that the Part D costs in 2014 dropped $0.5 billion, costing the United States government and the Medicare program, because when asked about this, the people who stopped taking expensive medication said, I've gone to marijuana. I got it right. Yeah.
How much is that figure going to drop when the other 25 states jump on board, you know?
Well, I don't know. Everybody knows how to do the math. Yeah.
We need to start focusing on that federal level. And you know what else? Yeah. Not all the old people are buying in, though, because there's a Publix heiress in Florida where they're having a big fight this November. They got it on the ballot again for a legalization measure. The Publix heiress gave $800,000 to fight against the legalization measure that Florida's putting on the ballot.
Yeah, yeah.
And I guess...
You know, they don't want to believe... They don't want to believe what we just heard. And, of course, they always bring up like bad things. Well, you know, you don't have to smoke pot in order to
reap the benefits.
Yeah, to reap the benefits. You can throw out the OxyContin and walk into one of the legal shops right here in Fort Collins, and they've got they got two rooms of nothing but like candy store pot stuff that you can take, which just cuts your pain and ache right away.
Well, and here's really the thing. Works. Barnett, the woman we were talking about, she's 59 years old. She has early onset Alzheimer's and had to resign from the company's board last month. And that just so happens to be one of the major things that they're using medical marijuana to treat is Alzheimer's.
Yes.
So maybe she's forgotten that she has Alzheimer's. I don't know.
Seizures and Alzheimer's are huge. And plain old pain, arthritic pain, goes away with using, walk in to the store, buy one of these things. You don't even have to smoke the stuff. They've got it in pills, in candy, in cookies. Wait till you come here and visit. It'll blow your mind, you know? So, yeah, and it's saving fractions of billions of dollars already. And you know what? Here we go. The government has, you know, the government's not stupid. They're just sleazy.
Yeah.
So the government is watching this. You know they're watching this, and they're going, oh, wow. So don't be surprised if you hear in the next handful of numbers of years, more and more, you know, state governments will start to think about this and turn it around. It'll probably take a little extra longer for the feds to get with it because they're extra.
It ever happens there.
Yeah, right. So that's a very, very good thing in the pro-marijuana thing. There's lots of people. I mean, we're talking in the dozens and dozens of millions of U.S. citizens that are now doing this in order to generate this kind of numbers of dollars of savings.
Well, like we were saying, over half the states have medical marijuana laws in some form or another. So it's happening. Now, in reference to that, we had discussed briefly an article earlier in the week where there is one state that's trying to include minorities into the pot legalization boom.
Yes,
by
indeed.
Kind of, what is it? It's a weed equal opportunity law or something along those lines?
That's what they're proposing. The state is Ohio, which 1 or 2 weeks ago, I told you that according to some data that I had 2 or 3 weeks ago, the number one state where Mexican cartels, are you listening to this on the radio waves? The number one state in this country, the number two state in this country where the Mexican cartels are trying to get in and grow pot in faraway places where no one will see it. That's Colorado. But the number one place in the country is Ohio. There's huge areas there that are being cultivated with pot by Mexican cartels. And I think we mentioned that.
Well, so, and aren't they one of the states crying about legalization going through in Colorado? Weren't they trying to sue them? Or was that was
no.
Nebraska and Oklahoma?
No, that was crybaby Nebraska. Go screw yourself, Oklahoma. And I don't know, there was another one, but they can all go do weird things with themselves.
So, how did that relate? Now you were telling me a story in your neck of the woods, or is it in Denver?
Oh, yes, indeed. Yeah. Well, okay. Yeah. Remember what we were just talking about a moment ago, Ohio. has a law coming up, and they want this. There's a coalition, and the coalition is pushed by mostly a black group, where they're saying, hey, you know, blacks aren't getting. This is what they're stating. I'm looking at the 4-page data sheet here. There's a group there supporting black people, saying it's not fair. In the states where pot is becoming legalized in one way or another, there's tons of money going in. Companies are being produced, pots being produced, and money's by being made, and great. However, they're saying bunches of this is mostly made by whites. Their words, not mine, by whites. And
we prefer the term honky.
cracker. I always use cracker, you know. There's not enough helping of black people in Ohio. Helping. What does helping mean? Helping means what? What? They can't get enough money to do the same thing that the crackers
honkies are doing.
Yeah, honkies are doing. You know, and I guess not. However, there's a group that's saying, hey, you know, come on, we need to have a group in each state that helps to equalize, no matter what color you are, no matter what your income is, which is crazy because it costs money to run a pot shop.
Oh, it costs hundreds of thousands of dollars just to get it licensed and started.
Up front, absolutely.
Well, you know what? I agree. They should have some sort of grant system that they can set up. Or
that's a great idea, but it's probably stopped because of the federal level. The feds don't want to like suddenly start kicking in some grant money.
Well, that's what they're going to have to do for the agricultural market. I mean, we were talking about it. One of my friends up in Maine, where they've had industrial hemp legalized for a while, he's saying, you know, they can grow the hemp, but the problem is there's no real technology or existing infrastructure for taking that hemp and turning it into textiles. Turning it into oils, turning it into paper.
That's controlled by two mega institutions, the United States government and the United States military. The military is the number one user of marijuana, hemp, that is, which is pot without any good shit in it. Hemp is the number one source even now of the United States Navy's rope. All the rope in the United States military, they don't use polyester and all that, all those other kinds of fake rope. They still use hemp rope.
So what we need to be working on is getting that infrastructure made accessible by public entities, you know, private entities.
Well, yes, indeed. Yeah, you know, yeah.
Because you can grow as much industrial hemp as you want, but you can't do anything with it. And if we really want to be competitive in the market, we have to start researching and working that end of it now.
I don't
care if you're black, white, Hispanic, Chinese, whatever. You deserve access to that kind of research if you're willing to put in the effort and the work and lay down the foundation. Yeah, let's make it easier.
And sometimes problematically come up with the starting money.
Yeah.
And this article said, oh, come on, people. White people have more startup money than blacks do. So thus, this article said, we're afraid that pick a number, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years from now, all the marijuana processing companies' areas will be owned by whites and the blacks will have missed out. Now, I think that's the kernel of this article that you and I are talking about. But
But the thing is, if I wanted, I'd be under the same restrictions. You know, if I was rich, it doesn't matter if I'm black or white. If I'm rich, I can do what the hell, whatever I want. I think that's exactly how I felt when I read this article. And it's just, it's another way to increase tensions between whites and blacks. You know, we need to stop doing things by what's politically correct and start doing things based on what's the word I'm looking for? Credibility?
Political correctness?
Accountability. Not accountability, but credibility. Whoever's best suited or has the best credentials for the job should get the job.
Should get it. I was talking to the lady that owns my pot shop. My, as in the one that I would go to were I to go to buy some pot. And she said it cost her multiple hundreds of thousands of dollars for the investment.
Yep.
And a lot of people who would like to jump into that don't have that.
No. So that's the nature of the beast.
So there's a question as to, is there an unfairness, here we go again, between whites, blacks, et cetera, et cetera. And I don't think so. You know, it's white privilege. I can't afford this at all.
It's white privilege, but the privilege is that there's a lot more white people that exist. That's the privilege. It's your demographic, if you have a larger demographic to work with, then you can capitalize more off of it. And that's the basic economics. It's not racism. Yep. I hate to break the fucking news to everybody.
Yeah, I know. But there's some people still want to throw that word out. But.
All right. So listen, we are.
I'll tell you what. Later on, if we have time, I can tell you about this mini article about how what we were just talking about had something to do with a problem with a neighborhood with too many pot shops in Denver.
Oh, yeah. We will come back to that. But listen, we got to go to a break. We babbled on way too long. I got to get a leash on you, brother. We still have the new song from Group Love coming up. We're going to be playing that soon. And I wanted to take a moment before I forget to thank our sponsors, Green Side Up, Can of Care, Merchants Bank Card Systems. Thank you guys for making all of this happen. We have a song from Alt J back in 2012. It's called Fitz Pleasure. And you're listening to 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org. La tra la tra la tra la tra la tra la tra.
In your side feels pleasure, boom shape pleasure. Deep greeting, googling a boy. Thank you.
hardest men that queue to be the next.
And welcome back to 13 Folds Radio on rifreeradio.org. That was the Bahamas, a song called All the Time. And we still have the new song from Group Love coming up at you next. But before we go there, we are going to finish up our discussion with Spock from Colorado. Are you there, Spock?
I still am, and I'm having a blast. How you doing?
I'm doing good. I'm ready for my second drink, finally.
Started mine. Yeah.
But as we discussed last week, we've realized that we're actually cut down to an hour and 20 minutes, even though we do well over a two-hour show. So we're going to get that song out for you guys right before the hour and 20-minute mark. But before we go there, I wanted to discuss the item that Spock was talking about before we went to break.
Okay. I'll tell you what. I'll try not to be my usual talkative self.
Oh, yeah. Keep it quick. Short and quick.
Now, okay. Here we go. Sometimes, here it is. Here's the top of the thing. Sometimes problems can arise in a neighborhood because too much drugs or too much betting or too much money dealing, too much bad general shit is going on in your neighborhood. And then the people have to rise up and say, what the fuck? Let's get this out of here.
Yeah, too much of anything is bad.
Yeah, especially a bad thing. So in Denver, sure enough, this happened. There's a nice neighborhood. You know, Denver is freaking huge. Denver is about the same size as half of Massachusetts. You can't believe how big the city is.
All right.
Anyway, there was a group of people, especially one or two particular people, who said, "Hey, you know, here we go." Well, let me back up. Fort Collins, Colorado has 14, by law, maximum pot shops in it. Now, I know that sounds like a lot. Denver has no limit. Denver has approximately 400 pot shops in the city.
All right. Okay. Now what you're saying is one of them is in a nicer neighborhood?
No. 10 of them.
Ten of them are in a nicer neighborhood. Okay.
Yeah, and it's not even a nicer neighborhood.
All right, so what's happening here?
Ten of them have grown like wet mushrooms in kind of a bad, problematic neighborhood. A low socioeconomic neighborhood. Predominantly, I'm reading it off the newspaper here, Hispanic and Black neighborhood where 12, not 10.
All right, so 12 shops are open.
12 new shops have opened. And, of course, a lot of the people in the neighborhood are saying, whoa, look at this. This is like all we see are cars and people and weirdos. And, this is not good having this. So
they're selling blankets and liquor.
No, they got legal, licensed. Legal, licensed pot shops. 12 of them in a space of 3 city blocks.
And it's bringing the riffraff. Is that what?
And it's bringing the riffraff. It's bringing tons of money, but only for the shops and the taxes that are generated by that. But all the people in the neighborhood aren't getting shit except a lot of shit.
And do you think this is because there's just too many shops in one area? Like if it was all condensed to 2 or 3 shops, don't you think they'd still have the problem?
You know what? It's interesting because that's the question that this article proposes. This article says, and it talks about at the very beginning, the beginning paragraph, hey, there are a few people that said enough. So they took it to the town government and said, no, 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 this is crazy. We used to have a cool, low socioeconomic, all Hispanic, you know, all black neighborhood here. And everything was kind of fine and cool. And then these guys come in, they establish 12 shops, 12 pot shops, quick as you can think of. And boom, now the whole thing has gone to hell.
Okay, so now who are the locals that own these shops, or is it like a bigger corporation that's not from these areas?
It's not. No. The first thing, it's locals. It's locals that have managed to come up with the starter money,
the funding,
and so on. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So let's get down to the root of it then. So what we were just talking about is how they have it. They want people in those neighborhoods to be able to own the shops to better the neighborhoods. Now this is having the reverse effect.
Yeah, absolutely. And what they're afraid of, they didn't say that it's been happening. And here's the end of the story. What the neighborhood is afraid of is that criminality in all its spiky points is going to land on this neighborhood. And before you know it, they're all going to have to move out. And the whole neighborhood's going to turn to shit. And they asked the town, long story short, they asked the town, can we stop this? And the town said, yeah. And the town is said that they're taking it under advisement to begin to analyze this situation and maybe stop it, quell it, or do something about it. And
yeah, I'm interested to find out why that neighborhood specifically, this is generating problems where there's other bad neighborhoods that have pot shops in them.
Yeah, this one just happened to be in the target, I think. I think it was just an accident, according to what I sense from the article.
All right.
I just think it was a whole bunch of people said, hey, oh, look it, I got enough money to do this, set this up, da-da-da. And then before you know it, there was a whole bunch of people, each with enough starter money. The licenses are cheap in Denver. There's no limit. It's not like Fort Collins.
All right. Well, we're running out of time for this segment.
Okay,
and
we gotcha.
Let's talk about how I think they got the money. There was a $3 million lotto winner from Georgia who I guess invested his winnings to fund an illegal meth ring. Have you heard about that one?
Oh, Jesus, God.
Yeah, Georgia man who won millions in the lottery.
What did this guy have, an IQ in single numbers?
he's going to face life in prison after pleading guilty.
After winning a million.
Yeah, so that, you know, maybe that's how they funded all this shit. Listen, there's still more. We're at our hour and 20-minute mark, coming right up fast. Before we go there, I once again want to thank Greenside Up, Merchants Bank Card Systems, Canacare. Thank you guys for helping us put this together. And thank you, Tony Jones. Vote for him for Libertarian in the Town Council of North Kingston. We got more to talk about, but you're going to have to go find us on 13folds.com or look us up on Facebook so you can find a way to the extended podcast where I'm still going to be playing some more new music. I got the one from Prophets of Rage coming up tonight.
Quick, man.
But you're going to have
before you go away, do you want me to stay and I'll just talk for a 1 minute about this cool Suicide Squad evaluation?
I want you to stay and we can wrap this shit up tonight again. So
okay.
Hang out, man.
We're good.
Hang out. Get another drink. You got a little bit of time. We're going to play the new group Love Song right now. It's called Welcome to Your Life. It's off of Big Mess, the album that is coming out, I believe, later in the month. But this is the only song that they've released yet. You're hearing it here first on 13 Folds Radio, rifreeradio.org.
We're back in business. Sure do.